Don't be discouraged. Yes. In the morning. Yes. Know that God is nigh. Yeah. Stand still and look up. Yes. I want to let you know that God is going to show up, and He is showing up in every process that you are in. I really like this song. It's called Healing by Richard Smallwood, and we'll listen to a little bit more of that later. But right now, I want us to talk. I want you to relax. And we're going to talk about something that's just real. A lot of times people in the church don't want to talk like what I'm about to say, but we're going to have some real talk. You know what? It's just not fair. Yeah, it's just not fair. It's not fair, the things that you have gone through. Many of you have endured such incredible injustices, such hurt, such pain. You have gone through things that are really unspeakable. You have been abandoned. You have been hurt. You have been lied to. You have been cheated. And it's just not fair. You know, when I look up that word fair, the word fair means in accordance with the rules or standards, legitimate. And some of you have had some things that I know and I understand. So things that were just not, they were against the human rule, the human rule of decency, the human rule of love, respect, and honor. And I want you to know that I understand. We are going to talk about how it's just not fair. You know, first of all, the things that you've gone through, and then the fact that you have to participate in the healing process. I mean, that definitely doesn't make sense, especially since you didn't bring the situation on to yourself. So we're going to have a three-part series, just a little short three-part series called It's Just Not Fair. So we're going to start right there. I want you to first know that I agree with you. I agree with you. It's just not fair. It's just not fair about what you've gone through, and I apologize on behalf of those who have not apologized to you. It's just not fair what you've gone through, and it's just not fair that you have to participate in a healing process for something that was thrust on you. Why do you have to do anything? I definitely understand. I want you to know I know how you feel. I have been there. And I wish that I could change the fact that you do have to participate in your own healing process. I wished I could have changed that for me. Definitely. I'm looking at some of my notes. It says, during the times that my heart was crushed, I wanted the pain to evaporate. But also, I wanted those who hurt me to suffer. I did. Now, some people won't admit that, but the truth of the matter is, yeah, I thought that they should have been dealt with because they thrust hurt on me for no reason. I felt that somehow my holding on to the pain, or at least rehearsing the events, would make me feel better. Yeah. I felt that whatever happened to me was significant. It was significant, and it was worth recognizing. And I owed it to myself to erect a statue that represented the hurt. And I glazed upon it periodically to remind myself about what happened. Some of us decided that we wouldn't look at it at all. That was our way of saying, I want to wish this away. Me, I looked at it and I rehearsed it over and over again. I wanted to stop hurting, but I didn't want those who had wronged me to stop hurting. So I waited. Yeah, I waited and I held on to the poison and I waited. And I thought that somehow I could hold on to the poison and get better at the same time. I mean, I wasn't exactly sure how all that looked or how that would work out, but that's what I wanted. And some of you want that even now. Anytime anyone begins to talk about abandonment or neglect, or hurt or pain or molestation, there is a defense mechanism that rises up, a shield that rises up like, well, no, don't touch this. Don't try to tell me how I should relieve myself or relieve the person. No, I'm miserable and I'm just fine because I feel justified. Yeah, it hurts. Yeah, but it wasn't fair. And I want you to know, I understand. So I held on to my poison. And like I said, honestly, it satisfied a part of me. It memorialized for me what happened. And for me, that was enough. And some of you may be right there. And that was the season that I was in. Nobody could prop me out of that season, no matter what scripture they use. No matter what they tell me about Jesus, no matter what they tell me about the dangers of holding on to poison, I did not care. Because for that season, before I learned some other things, for that season, I stayed right there. It was enough. It was enough for a season. But the problem that I found, and I don't know about you, is that there was a downside to this statue that I had erected. There was a downside to holding on to the poison. And what I found was that I sank deeper into depression and anxiety. So there I was, heartbroken and depressed, shattered and filled with the terror of anxiety and heartbroken. Crazy. That wasn't fair either. I spent years seated right there. I waited and I waited. But nothing happened for me. And the thing that ticked me off was the lives of the perpetrators continued. I'm like, really? How could this be? I was getting worse and worse. And the ones who hurt me were going on with their life. I was wounded. I was stuck. And they were perpetrators and they were free. That wasn't fair. And then I began to notice that by holding on to the poison, that I began to bleed. I began to bleed that poison onto others that had nothing to do with what happened to me. People that I loved, other loved ones, my children, my co-workers, because the attitude, the anger that I had, the resentment, it started coming out and bleeding on to other people. Okay, so now I'm heartbroken, depressed, filled with anxiety, and allowing the overflow of the poison to touch others. Wow. It was getting worse and worse. And I stood still. And the others, the perpetrators, just moved on. So finally, I decided that the place that I was in was not yielding anything profitable for me. And that I realized I was just getting older and older. And I could die drowned in my ashes. I could die depressed. I could die filled with anxiety. I could die bitter. I could die that way. And to make matters worse, I would die and those who I love that had nothing to do with it had been infected. So now I was a perpetrator. Now that wasn't fair for them. There was a lot of work that needed to be done. And I will continue on our next segment telling you how I made some decisions. But I want to let you know something. There's healing for you. Mm-hmm. Believe it or not, there's healing. Even for the things that are not fair. Meet me again for part 2. God bless you.